Our gospel this morning comes from Mark, the first chapter, verses 9 through 15.
Glory to the Lord.
In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." The gospel of the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Invite you to see. So some of you may be thinking, this week's Bible verse sounds a little familiar. And if you are, you have a very sharp memory and are to be commended. Because we read the first part of this Bible verse about 6 weeks ago for the baptism of Jesus. We're in the Gospel of Mark this year, and as we read about Jesus being baptized, we read about the sky being torn open and the Spirit that's ascending and the voice from heaven. But what we didn't read was what happened immediately afterwards, and immediately is a big word in Mark. Mark likes to keep things moving, all right? If you're the kind of person who wants to stay on schedule and keep to task, Mark is your guy, all right? There's no lollygagging in his gospel. Immediately, the Spirit drives the Son, drives Jesus out into the wilderness where he faces temptation. And it's very important to note, that the temptation in Mark is not the same as it is in Matthew and Luke. In Matthew and Luke, you have Satan kind of seducing Jesus to sin, asking him to do things for rewards, tempting him in that sense. In Mark, temptation is more, the word temptation that Mark uses is more test or trial. It's conflict. The idea is that Jesus is out in the wilderness doing battle for 40 days with the forces that defy God. And then he comes back, hears that John the Baptist has been arrested, and immediately, once again, proclaims the good news that the kingdom of God has come here and calls for repentance and belief in the good news. That is a lot happening in a very few short verses. That's a lot of stuff to happen in 6 verses. All right? Mark really did believe that brevity was the soul of wit. Thank you, Myrna. You are allowed to laugh. It is a good thing. So, it is so easy for us to get so caught up in this story and how one thing just happens right after the next, after the next, after the next, that it is easy to miss exactly what is happening. But something amazing, and life-altering, actually cosmically changing the world, is happening in this text. And I really want to dig deep into this and explore this with you on this Sunday morning. And to do that, we have to go back about 4,000 years to Noah. This brings us all the way back to Genesis, and I don't know how many of you caught it, when Sue read the introduction, it's a little jarring when we look at what the Noah story is actually about, because we like to think of Noah's Ark as those really fun, colorful murals that we paint paint on nurseries and Sunday school rooms. You know, we like to think of the children's books with the animal noises and the mobiles and the play sets and all those fun things. Because, you know, it's something that sounds good to kids. It's got rainbows, it's got boats, it's got animals. What's not to love, right? The whole destruction of the earth thing is what's not to love. When we look at this story, and this is a story that most theologians, that I myself have struggled with, people who study it, when you read the Bible, when you read Genesis, there's almost kind of a stopping moment where you're like, hold on, did God just destroy the world? And that's hard to reconcile for us. It is hard for us to grasp that idea with the loving, merciful God we know. And to understand it, we actually have to look at part of a text that we didn't study today. We have to look at why. We have to look at what motivates God's actions. And when we go back a few verses, a great biblical practice, if you're reading the Bible at home, is to read 10 verses before and 10 verses after any particular Bible text, because it's going to expand your understanding of how that text is read. It's a wonderful, they teach that trick to pastors all the time, and I tell it to anybody who I know is reading the Bible. 10 verses before and after the section that you're reading will really change your perspective on a lot of texts. And if we go back, we find out that God is heartbroken. Creation has become something God does not recognize. Creation has gone from being something that God said, let there be, and it is good, to something that is rebelled against God to the point where it is filled with violence, corruption, greed, and self-destruction. And this breaks God's heart. We're not talking about the vengeful wrath of God. We're not talking about God saying, you're not playing by my rules, so I'm going to wipe you all out. We are talking about God who is grieved so deeply and so heartbroken that he can see almost no other option. And God decides that he's going to unmake creation. But there is grace in this midst of darkness, chaos, and death, because God sees a glimpse of something, a tiny sliver of something in what God has made that is worth preserving, protecting, and hoping in for the future. The Ark story is about how God looks upon creation and weeps. But instead of giving up on it entirely, God decides to cleanse it. God decides to save it. God decides to restore it. And in the waters of the flood, there is baptism. This is the root of the cleansing rituals that we have and of baptism. But at the end, God decides that this isn't the way. And as the floodwaters recede and Noah and his wife and his son and sons and their wives come out of the ark with the animals, God makes a covenant, a promise. God says, you know what? I'm never doing this again. I'm never going to try to fix humanity, fix creation by destroying it. God says, no longer will I attempt to bring my kingdom to earth through violence and death. And as a sign of that covenant, the bow, the rainbow, is planted in the clouds. And one of the commentaries I was reading this week had a really interesting perspective. It really pointed out that the rainbow, the bow, is not just a reassurance to us, but it is a reminder to God. It is a reminder to God when things are going wrong that God has said, I'm not doing that again. And if you think that God's heart doesn't break for our world, for the kingdoms that humanity has created, well, let me tell you, think again. Because I'm sure God weeps. I'm sure that God is grieved and heartbroken when people are wiped out in genocide and war. I know that God must cry when he hears the cries of people who starve, hears at the same time people who die from eating and having too much. God weeps about the imbalance of creation. God weeps when we can't talk to each other because the problems are too big and we don't even know how to find the words to do it. And I know God joined us in weeping when yet another school was visited by violence this past week. The rainbow is a reminder to God of God's promise to do things differently. And throughout the season of Lent, we will be reading each of the five covenants that happen in the New Testament or the Old Testament. Each of God's attempts to try and bring his kingdom into reality. And then we will get Jesus. God's final and successful attempt to bring his kingdom to earth. Jesus, who will spend 40 days at the beginning of his ministry doing battle in the wilderness. This is not a story about resisting temptation so that we can feel good about ourselves or punishing ourselves because we give in. This isn't about, you know, not eating chocolate for 40 days or making the right choice all the time. This is a story about God's kingdom clashing with the kingdom that the world has built, the kingdom that we live in our everyday lives. The kingdom of humanity, where we lift ourselves up, fight to get ahead, where we look after our own interests with fierce and oftentimes unfortunate and cruel practices. God comes in and says, this is not what I want for creation. And I will restore it with my kingdom of justice and peace and plenty. If you want to know what the kingdom of God looks like, the Bible is filled with it. All right? Read through, and I cannot believe I'm saying this, but read through some of the Leviticus and Numbers. I know, Myrna's making the face like, good God, don't read those. Okay, so I'm giving you permission to ignore the parts about, you know, stoning people and eye for an eye and all that, okay? Just skip over that. But read the part that Jesus, where God is handing down the laws to his people and says, this is how you're supposed to treat people. Read about what Jesus says about business practices. Or God, sorry. God and Jesus are kind of the same thing in my head, so I better change that. Anybody who wants to talk about that with me, that's another sermon. God says, this is how you should do business with each other. This is how you should treat your servants or your employees. This is how you should treat strangers and foreigners who come into your country. This is how you should treat children and the sick and the ill and the disabled and the widow. This is how you should take care of each other. There's rules in the Bible about how every 50 years all the slaves should be set free, and all debt should be zeroed out so that each generation can find a level playing field. There's visions in the Bible about how we will treat each other fairly and leave something extra for those in need and take what we need and not more. God's kingdom is described to us through the miracles and the healing and the teaching of Jesus. And as we journey with Jesus over these next few weeks through Lent, God's kingdom breaks into the reality of the world in more and more dramatic ways. Through the healing of people, through the inclusion of the outcast, through the feeding of the hungry, and justice given to those who have been oppressed. And the world rallies against it. It rejects it because the power is not ours anymore. It belongs to Jesus. It belongs to God. And God brings his kingdom in through the love, the submission, and even the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. This is the journey of Lent. This is what we start taking together today, is the journey of God's kingdom breaking into the reality of our world here and now, and challenging us to turn back, to repent, meaning to turn back to God and God's kingdom, to think about how we do business, to think about how we treat each other, to have difficult conversations, to talk about things that make us uncomfortable, to protect each other, and to value life. This is the kingdom of God, and it is coming into our world here and now. It is God's promise and covenant with us. And the brilliance of it is how God brings it in, not through destruction and chaos and death, but God remembers his promise to us, brings us life through Jesus Christ. Repent and believe the good news, for the kingdom of God has drawn near. And that is our hope. That is our vision. That is who we are.